I've paid thousands of dollars in courses to learn what you're basically teaching on your podcast for free. What you're putting out there is so valuable. So, you know, I just really want to acknowledge you, and I definitely send everyone to your podcast.
You were virtually one of the first mentors that I looked up to and started following. You're always one step ahead of the game. So I just wanted to give you kudos and props for that, because lots of people are watching, lots of people are learning from it.
Tucker and the whole TTM crew, Dan and Chris, thanks so much for your support. I love what you guys do and a huge, huge fan. Having this support's huge. So I'm grateful for that.
What's up, everybody out there in listener land? This is episode 326 of the Real Dealz podcast. And as always, I'm your host, Tucker Merrihew. I got another great episode for you guys this week. I've actually been doing these episodes live on Facebook. So whenever I do an actual interview with somebody else versus just kind of a solo show, I'm doing them live on Facebook. And then we're taking the recording and we're putting them on here for you guys to listen to as well. So if you heard it on Facebook, well, you get to hear it again. And if you haven't, you can always go friend request me, or I'm actually streaming them to my personal wall so that you can go watch them there. So if you didn't hear it there, you'll hear it here. But this week's show, I've got a gentleman on. The name of Mr. Corey Thompson. He's been on the show before. Big presence in the Texas market, right? Everything's bigger in Texas. He does a lot of content. He's got a group called Roughneck to Real Estate. It's got a ton of people that are part of that, and he puts out a hell of a lot of content, some pretty funny videos, some of which has got him in trouble, which we talk about a little bit on this week's show. But more than anything, we just talk about, you know, coronavirus, real estate market, kind of the last 3 months and the wild ride that we've been on, how his business has, expanded again as we've gone through this roller coaster of economic events and pandemics and everything else that's going on. Kind of a crazy 3 months, we'll call it. So I wanted to have a candid conversation with him, a real conversation, and just talk about all things real estate and all things coronavirus and how they're all kind of intertwined and what business looks like right now. So I know you guys are going to dig it, and that's this week's show. Now, before we get into that interview, a few things I want to talk about. Number one is a couple housekeeping items. Our Driving for Dollars app, for those of you guys that have not downloaded it, you heard Corey talk about it. He was a major user of it. He still uses it. But our Driving for Dollars app, all you got to do is go to the iTunes Store, Google Play Store, download it for free. You get a 5-property free trial, and then plans start as for as little as $20 a month with skip tracing or unlimited list building. You choose, and you can kind of go up from there depending on how big a list you want to create and how much skip tracing you want to do within the app. But as Corey mentioned in the interview, this past few months has been a great time to really build your D4D list or go out and just actively try and connect with people that own investment grade property. We've done it a ton. We actually just put one under contract today because of that. And as Corey mentioned, you know, he basically does the same thing. And he goes out and he kind of poaches these investment grade properties, and he basically finds out, okay, who owns it? What's their contact information? Either shoots them some sort of a crazy text message or a call, and gets a conversation going. Now, he's a little, he can get away with some stuff that maybe most of us can't on the text message front that he sends to people. But point is that he instigates conversation, and it's a great way to generate inventory to buy. So if you have not already, go to the iTunes Store or the Google Play Store and download the Driving for Dollars app. It's the only one that's called that because we got the trademark on it. Now, beyond that, we've got a lot of people that are in our Deal Fighters Academy. Actually, we had a lot of people that have been joining lately, which has been fantastic. And so if you would like to join myself and about 115 other of some of the best investors from across the country, and really just a lot of really great people, we'd love to have you. So go to thedealfindersacademy.com and book a call with Dan. He'll chat with you. We'll see if it's a good fit. And most of the time it is, as long as you either want to get into real estate or you're actually in real estate doing deals. It's just a great community to be a part of. It's really cost effective. It's an online mastermind group. We get together, or we try to get together once a year here in Portland, and we're here to support each other on a daily basis with all kinds of tips, tricks, little competitive advantages, crazy stories, advice, just whatever it is that you need on an ongoing basis to kind of feel like you're part of a community, and a really great community, one that's been around. I mean, we're going on 6 or 7 years now this community's been around, so it's not one that's going to disappear overnight, that's for sure. And we've got a lot of really, really quality people in it. So go to thedealfindersacademy.com, book a call, and we'd love to chat with you. And as long as we don't have somebody in your exact area, we'd love to admit you, but As we said before many a times, we don't stack people directly on top of each other that have conflicting business models. So, or like business models, I should say. So go to dealfindersacademy.com, book a call. We'd love to hear from you. Now, what's going on with me this week? Well, kind of a big week. As we talk right now, we actually bought a house today. Officially got the, we're released to record right before I recorded this, which is going to be a teardown project for us. We bought the lot for about $600,000, a little short of that. We're going to have a new construction home that we're going to build on there that'll probably be worth somewhere in the 2.2 to 2.3 range when we're done with it. And of course, we've got to build, I don't know, somewhere around 4,200 square feet in the interim. But once we get started on that, it should go up in about 6 months. But the individual that we bought it from, they're going to rent back for about a month or so here as we get our plans done and all that. But pretty excited about that. It's in an A-plus area. It's an A-plus lot. Really, really good spot. So that's going to be one of our high-end products that we probably document a lot, take a lot of pictures of. And it should sell really well even in the high-end market just because of the location. Now, other than that, we also just put one under contract today, as I mentioned, which is in the same general area, but it's in a slightly lower price point part of that area. And it's one of those houses that I walked through initially. And I mentioned this in our DFA mastermind group, but sometimes when you walk through houses, and I mentioned it right after I did it, but sometimes when you walk through houses, you know that you got a winner, right? Right away, you know you got a winner. Sometimes you walk through houses and you know it's like, there's just so many things wrong with this house. Like, I looked at another one this past week that it was probably the creepiest house that I've been in a long time. I actually posted it to my Facebook wall as well, a little tour that I did. There was a squatter in there. He ended up being kind of downstairs when I walked in the house. But point is that house, it was so screwy and weird. You just spend the whole time trying to figure out, how can I fix it, right? Well, the one that we put under contract today, it's one of those that you walk into and it's got all the bed bath counts correct. It's got the layout correct. It's got everything is right. And it was actually taken care of really well also. So we're going to do just a little few tweaks to it and then we'll put it back to market. So it'll be a quick flip for us. But it's one of those houses that you walk in and you immediately know that it's a winner. And so I'm excited that we got that under contract. So bought one today. We put one under contract today. It's been a busy week for us. But beyond that, we're also moving offices, as I probably mentioned on last week's show. So I'm boxing up all of the crap that I've been accumulating over the last, I don't know, I guess it's been 13 years that we've been at the office here. So I guess one might say that I'm a bit of a hoarder, or I'm at least learning that about myself in the fact that we've been here for this long and I've just accumulated crap. I don't know that necessarily makes me a hoarder, but as you stay somewhere for a longer period of time, it's sort of like moving out of a house. You just accumulate more and more crap. And so I've got boxes upon boxes here behind me of stuff that needs to go get shredded. I've got boxes upon boxes of stuff that we just needs to be taken to the dump. And so it feels good to purge the office space. But more importantly than that, we're moving to a new space that's about a minute and a half, 2 minutes from my house, about a minute from the school that my kiddos are going to go to, right in the middle of downtown Lake Oswego. And it's just a great location. We got a rooftop deck. We're going to do some really cool stuff, not only with content, but we're going to host some really cool events there, kind of moving forward if we ever actually get summer weather. But we'll be moved in completely as of the beginning of July. And we'll have a rooftop deck there. We're going to host a lot of kind of real estate happy hours and do a bunch of other stuff there. So for those of you guys that are listening, we're also thinking about doing like a monthly, I don't want to call it meetup, but where we have maybe one or two people come in to town. They can hang with us. They can come to the office. They can see the marketing machine at work, how we do it, kind of behind the scenes there. They can see the construction side of things, how we do that, how we target certain properties, what we look for, go out to the job sites that we've got in terms of projects going on, and then also really dig into the design side, because we're bringing the design side under the same roof. As of right now, my wife Joni, who runs the design side, she is outside of this office just because it's just worked out better that way. But as we go into a nice new office, we're actually bringing it all together. So point is that as we move forward, we may have something going on here where we put together a program where you guys can come in and kind of spend a couple of days with us. So keep an eye out for that. I'll give you more details as we kind of move forward. But now that we've got a really cool office space and we've got everything under one roof, I think it'd be really cool to have some of you guys come out and check out what we've got going on and really teach you a lot in terms of not only the marketing, but the construction, and then of course the design as well. So keep an ear out for that. Now, other than that, well, I think that's it. This is a long interview with Corey. I won't say it's an interview, it's a conversation. These are the ones that I like to do because I just get to talk some smack. We get to talk about what's going on in the world of real estate, business, otherwise, and hopefully you guys get some out of it. So without further ado, let's get into my conversation with none other than Mr. R2R himself, Mr. Corey Thompson. All right, Real Deals podcast listeners, I want to talk quickly about our show's sponsor, Iron Bridge Lending. If you guys have not reached out to Iron Bridge already to talk to them about funding some of your upcoming flip projects, I highly encourage you to do so. I've known the owner of Iron Bridge for a very long time. I personally borrowed millions of dollars from them over the years to do a number of different projects, and I can say without a doubt, they are the best hard money lending company I have ever come across, and that is the reason why they are the sole sponsor of this show. I've had a lot of other companies reach out to me and want to sponsor this show, but I just won't do it. I feel like I need to be genuine in who we have sponsoring the show, and it needs to be somebody that I've personally done a ton of business with. So I personally vouch for their ability to be the best, hands down, in the world of hard money lending. You won't find better programs, you won't find better terms, and they're lending or will be lending in over 20 states. So chances are, if you're hearing this in whatever state you're in, it's definitely worth it to check out their website, reach out to them, see if they're lending in your state, and if they are, I would absolutely encourage you to do business with them. Another very cool thing to note is that they have a program for most rehabs where you can actually borrow up to 90% of the purchase price. Now, this is given the fact that you are actually buying a deal, which if you're listening to the show, that means you probably are. But if you have an actual deal on the table, they'll fund up to 90% of your purchase price, and they'll even give you rehab funds on top of that, which means that it only takes 10% down to get into a project, which is unbelievable in the hard money world. So do yourself a favor, reach out to Iron Bridge Lending, have a conversation with them, see if they're a good fit for you and for your next project. I can guarantee you that you'll be happy that you did.
We are live. All right, everybody, welcome. This is this week's version of or episode of the Real Deals podcast. I've got a repeat gentleman on that's here with me this week, a fine gentleman, I should say. I'll give him a proper introduction, though. You all know who he is, but I'll give him a proper introduction. It is the, close your ears if you don't want to hear it, the motherfucker of mobile homes himself, Mr. R2R, aka Mr. Roughneck to Real Estate. What's going on, Mr. Corey Thompson?
Nothing much. Tucker, what you been up to? How are flips? You're in Portland, right?
I am. not for long. I'm leaving. I'm getting out of
really?
Portland. Well, I mean, I'm not going far. I'm going 10 minutes south. We're moving. You can see I got some boxes right here over my shoulder, wherever there. Anyway, over there. We're boxing up the office. We're our new place is going to be in Lake Oswego. So we're out of here at the end of the month, and we're heading south about 10 or 15 minutes.
You shared something recently about some sort of tax that was affecting certain counties. And I remember you shared it and I pulled it up and I thought, well, hell, I would just move into one of these other counties, because like Portland intersects at like three or four different counties there. I was like, man, that's going to really drive business their way. Yeah. Is that part of the reason for your move or no?
Somewhat, yeah. We got all kinds of problems. I mean, there's problems all over the place. I can't pick on Portland, right? We're in a 2020 is just, let's just give it the fuck back at this point. That's how I feel about it. But Portland's got a lot of problems. Our homeless problem is huge. We've got no control over it, which is unfortunate. We just need some stronger leadership to really create some real solutions for it. Right now, we're just playing, you know, political patty cake, and we're not actually solving anything. But the other issue is that we've got taxes that they've started to put on businesses. And so about 3 years ago, just to give you a quick backstory, I don't want to take up this whole interview talking about it, but they tried to push through a sales tax in Oregon. Well, sales taxes aren't very popular when you put them to vote to the people, because people don't want to pay sales taxes, right? I.e. the consumer, the normal Joe Schmo. And so what they decided to do, because that didn't work, is they repackaged it and they said, look, it's a big business tax and big businesses are going to pay for it. Well, big businesses are those that have over $750,000 a year in revenue. That's their idea of a big business. And so what it became was, it's called a CAT tax, and it's basically about 6% of gross revenue you're taxed on, right? It not net revenue, but gross revenue, which is essentially a sales tax. And then what they did on top of that, what I posted about, was they created a secondary revenue tax purely for homeless help or services, mm-hmm. or whatever it is, right, that they want to spend the money on. So they're putting another 1% on top of that. So really, if you're in Portland, you're going to pay about 8% in revenue tax for a variety of different things. 1% of that is specifically for homeless type stuff. So that's what I was bitching about, because I just think it's a bunch of bull, the way that they're ramrodding these things through and the way that they're selling it to the general population who just doesn't quite get it. And they kind of pit us against each other, saying it's big business, you got to get it, take it to the man, you know, and it's really not big business. It's small business. And for us in the real estate game, the way it works is, let's say we sell one of our houses for $1.5 million, right? we're not taxed on our profit margin. We're taxed, these revenue taxes tax the entire value of the asset. So if we sell it for $1.5 million, we're taxed on $1.5 million. We have to pay 7% of $1.5 million in taxes after we cross a certain threshold of sales. So it's crazy. It's insane. It's not a very tax.
I saw that.
Yeah.
I saw that and I did the math on it and I was like, man, we're going to cross $1 million worth of revenue in our little company this month. You know what I mean? In 1 month. So it's like, you know, that it just, it's asinine. Like I couldn't imagine that business climate. And then knowing that you can go 20 minutes from your current location and get rent and get away from it. It's even makes it even stupider. You know what I mean? It's like everybody who can leave will, and whatever's left behind will just be what's left behind. It's going to exaggerate. I don't even know if that's the right word.
Exacerbate. I know it sounds like a dirty word.
An already, terrible situation. But it is what it is. I mean, that's life. And most people don't realize it. They see it and they're like, oh man, this is terrible. So,
Yeah. And unfortunately we can't escape the about 6% cat tax. That's statewide. So everybody's pissed about that, but the additional on top of that, and then we've got some additional taxes. City of Portland gets you for a variety of other taxes too. So we just looked around and we said, look, where are we doing most of our projects? Well, we're not doing most of them in Portland anymore because of a variety of reasons. So I was like, you know what? Let's move a little closer to where I live. It'll just be a lot easier on life. I mean, I live 2 minutes away from the new office. My kids are going to go to school about a minute away on the other side. It's just the simplicity of life and less taxes. So we gone.
Well, I don't, you know, I look at Texas and that's you, before we went live, you talked about the, you know, Rona, and I was looking at it. We're rural investors. So they shut down evictions. They shut down all of this. And we're kind of looking at our small business. I think we've got 200 doors right now, give or take. We're looking at it going, okay, how many people are going to pay after the president comes out on the big TV and says, we're going to suspend evictions, when really it was, we're going to suspend evictions for HUD backed loans at that time. But then, I mean, almost a week after that, Texas Supreme Court suspends evictions for 2 months, but man, we made it. Like we did not lose occupancy. We gained occupancy. Right now we have lost 8 tenants out of 200 that we weren't able to either put on a payment plan, which we utilized Rhino deposit security to put them on a payment plan. So essentially if they needed 2 months of rent, that's $1,500. We say, okay, how long do you want to pay this back? You've got up to 3 years, no interest, no nothing. Just you got up to 3 years. And they'd say, okay, I want 3 years. All right, here's your new lease. It's for 3 years. You're going to insure the $1,500. You're going to surrender your deposit to us right now. And you're going to insure the $1,500 with Rhino's deposit insurance. So essentially, we just re-upped everybody on new leases with an insurance policy that if they break the lease, we're going to get that money back then. And we were able to kind of weather that storm and put money into our operating account by getting them to surrender their deposit to us. So it was kind of a neat move on our part that we came up with to make it work for our rental properties. But overall, rural America, we didn't end up in the bind that like Dallas right now, they have to give a 60-day notice to evict. I would give that notice every single month if I had a rental in Dallas. Like, I mean, it would go out every single month because 60 days is a, think about it like this, 1 month is 8%. That's 16% like loss right off the top if you have to evict somebody, not including your make ready cost, whatever it's going to take you to get at least. So, I mean, it's going to kill landlords in those communities if they keep this up.
Yeah. What, were you guys a little scared at the beginning of this whole thing? Cause I mean, I was going to get into this a little later, but I mean, this whole Rona thing happened, and then there was, you know, the one segment of the real estate market that has historically been rock solid was at like high risk, which is, you know, residential, multifamily, commercial, right? Were you guys, I mean, what were you thinking at the beginning of this? Or did you think, oh, this is how it'll play out if we do these things?
I didn't know. I was like, I don't know, dealing with, I don't want to call our tenants low budget, but they're lower end rentals. I mean, we're $500 to $1,000 a month rentals. It's like, what's their response going to be? They're going to have the money to pay rent, but what's their response going to be? We know the demand's going to go up. If there is a contraction in the marketplace, we know that our demand is going to go up. but what is our tenant's reaction going to be currently? Are they going to think this is a free ride? We had several that thought this was a free ride. We had to educate them on it. So we did that and kept track of the communication. So at first we were like, we don't know what rules we're playing with, so we don't know how to approach it. We just got to wait and see who's going to pay who's going to pay rent this month. From there, it's like, what are our cash reserves? Where can we, like, we've got credit lines. Will those credit lines still be there next month? So we operated our business on a lot of credit lines, right? So we didn't stay as liquid as we would have liked to have stayed once we looked at it in a pandemic. We're like, oh, we're not liquid enough. Because if they zap our credit lines, if banks just quit lending and say, you don't have a credit line anymore, we're fucked. So we started reaching out for private money, trying to replace credit lines with private money against equity and deals that we have, just kind of feeling people out like, hey, you loaned us money. We don't have it deployed. If we needed this, would you give it to us? Well, kind of. Our private money people, like, do you need capital back right now? Like, you know, have you lost your job? Are you going to need this $100,000 back to live on for the next year? What does that do? So really, I mean, it was kind of hitting us from all angles. Like, how many people are going to need their money back that we have deployed right now versus are the banks going to keep lending? That was our big, big question. We had several things in the middle of refi. So it's like, are we going to be able to depend on these refis? And will we still have private money in 45 days? Or will people want to get out of this market? So those were the things we were working on. From the tenant side of things, we knew that our product would be in demand if we could get it back. But you don't want to turn a unit if you don't have to, especially you don't want to be the bad guy in town. In a town of 4,000 people, you can't just start throwing 8 people out because they couldn't pay. And it's a business decision. You're going to have to turn those 8 units. So you're going to have to spend $1,000 a unit on them. What do you want to spend $8,000 or do you want to work with somebody? Normally, we wouldn't work with them. It just sets a bad precedent. They'll talk to their neighbor. They'll talk to their neighbor. They'll talk to their neighbor. Now you've got 20 people that want it. But in this situation, it's like, we are offering you this, but you have to get current on your rent right now. Like, you cannot have any past due. We're going to waive all late fees, but you have to get current right now. Then you can do this. And then keeping all of that communication in writing so we could take it to the judge and actually win in 2 months when they open things up. Look, we've tried to contact them here, 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 and here. We've offered them everything under the sun. Please give us our unit back. But we only had to do it with 8. That's really fortunate out of 200. I don't know what the national average was, but for us, it worked out really well.
I think it ended up being a much lower than people thought. Cause I mean, I know a lot of people that were very worried about rent collection, you know, starting in April and then again in May. And then, you know, here we are June, but it seems like it's worked itself out for the most part, which has been good, obviously, for your situation too.
Well, I think at the beginning it was kind of like, how soon you couldn't get into unemployment. Nobody could get access to it. So it's like, you know, if everybody's living paycheck to paycheck and now unemployment's available, but you can't get it filed, you're obviously going to choose to eat over rent. We understand that. We're not assholes. We've all been there, but you got to communicate that to us. If you don't communicate with us, we're just going to assume you're being sorry about it. And again, we knew that May would be the test because by then pretty much everybody had access to the government capital that was being deployed. And if they didn't choose to pay then, they weren't going to pay ever. And if they still weren't communicating. So, I mean, during that time, like, we're locked down and we cover the whole state of Texas. Hold on. We got Texas driving by in the background. Anyway, so now we're sitting there and it's like, we cover the whole state of Texas. During that time, during lockdown, I was driving and actually knocking on people's door and being like, all right, hey bro, you still live here? Yeah. We're offering payment plans. We've been emailing you. We've been calling you. I don't know if you know this about us yet. So we were in that communication with them at that time. And it was like, you know, we went door to door. We put notices on people's door and we documented all communication. So whenever things did open back up, we would have a shot at actually getting an eviction.
Do you think, I'm just curious, but like now that you've kind of moved forward, we got past this, do you feel like the people you're talking to, the appointments you're going on, do people seem like Rona didn't really happen now, or are people still a little reluctant to let you in the house? Did you even put on a mask? I mean, did you ever go to an appointment and have to put a mask on?
Yeah. So I was wearing a mask and hand sanitizer, the whole 9 yards. Still when I go in people's houses, I wear a mask, but I was doing it for businesses and everything else before it was the rule. You know, I still had to be out in it. I didn't know what it was. Didn't know if it was going to kill me. I didn't want to find out the hard way. So at the beginning, when things were unknown, I was doing that. We couldn't get an appointment. We couldn't buy an appointment. Appointments we had set wouldn't even let us in. We had agents getting listings canceled because they didn't want people coming into their house. So they're just like, hey, I don't want to sell my house anymore. And it was a problem. Finding new inventory was very difficult. I found it to be the toughest thing out of all of this. You know, renting, we lost 42 units in December, and we were still turning those units. So we had like 30 vacancies on our books. We leased all that. We don't have any more. We had also remodeled a couple of small apartment complexes that hit the market right in the middle of Rona. We leased all of those. Leasing was in high demand. New tenants were in high demand, but we could not get an appointment to get in. Once it started opening back up, just as a common courtesy, I always had a mask. I'd always ask, not shake hands. I mean, not shaking hands in Texas feels like you're going to go to hell. You know what I mean? It's like, oh man, like, this is it. This is, I don't want to be here not shaking this man's hand when Jesus comes back. So it was pretty interesting, but overall now when we go on appointments, I mean, it's not too bad, you know, but we're still not getting the appointments that we once were. I mean, there is no motivation to sell right now. Like, tax foreclosures aren't happening. Foreclosures aren't really happening. There's a ton of government buoyancy in the system. I know people that got EIDL loans for like 60 grand. They didn't even have a viable business in 2019. In 2019, they didn't have, they had an LLC. They were still trying, but you know, they got, I mean, 2.75% interest just for applying, basically a signature loan. It's crazy the amount of money. We had different farmers and ranchers that were losing money because of Rona that were lenders of ours, that were big lenders of ours. We had a $900,000 loan fall through from a farmer because he didn't know what Rona was going to be. But then those guys end up getting a grant from the government. Like, one guy I know, $100 a head for every stalker he had over 600 pounds. We're talking a $300,000 grant. Boom. Don't have to repay it. Nothing. He wasn't lending to us whenever we made those initial calls and said, hey, do you still want to lend? He's like, oh, no, I got to hang on to my money. This cattle market, we don't have a market to sell into. They can't slaughter them. It's, you know, we have no idea what's going to happen. I can't loan another dime. When that grant money hit, he called us up and he's like, hey, he was originally in at like 50,000. Then he was in at 110 when he came back from Rona. So it actually put more money into our pipeline in that aspect. So it's kind of a curse and a blessing. I mean, I can't really describe it. Did you apply for any of the government assistance? We applied for all of it. We got all of it. Did you apply for any?
No, and it wasn't because I just felt like I didn't need it. So it was kind of a personal choice, I guess. You know, and the way we're set up, just in full disclosure, if I could have got it for all of my employees, which technically aren't employees, they're independent contractors, then I would have done it for their sake. But I didn't do it for me because I felt there were people that needed it more. So I just didn't do it for that reason.
The PPP, we applied for it right out the gate. We applied for the SBA right out the gate just because at that time, you didn't know if you were going to need it or not. At least I didn't. True. You know what I mean? True. Once they gave us the money, the PPP, we needed it. When they gave it to us, it was like, oh, man, thank God. When we got our EIDL, it was kind of like, oh, this is good. You know what I mean? Like, this is going to help us out. So, I mean, 2.75% interest, 30-year loan. We just basically use that EIDL money. It's going to kind of pay off some credit lines and stuff like that. I mean, it really worked out kind of well on that side of the business for us.
Overall, as it should, right? I mean, that's what it was meant for. And I'm glad the people like you that got it, that it actually helps the business then springboards it forward, right? Because now you guys you're rocking and rolling because you've got this little springboard to help with. And the people, you got to take care of your people, right? And so the PPP takes care of your people that work for you that kind of make the organization. So it's all good stuff, that people that got it that needed it.
Well, I'm like, man, I couldn't believe it. It's just been an interesting deal, but you can't. Never in my life have I seen trillions of dollars get pumped into an economy just almost overnight and had it hit, like actually hit people I know. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, this is great for us as a company. We wanted to hire more people. Now we can hire more people. So It's been good. One thing that we did learn early on was we've got all these multifamilies. We've got multiple mobile home parks. We've been slowly selling them off, kind of just because they're stabilized and we want to test the market, see if there is a market for them, and people are buying them. So we were doing that. But when this hit, it was like, we don't know what the actual market is, because we should always have everything for sale all the time as real estate investors, because I don't care what people say, you make the most money when you sell something. You realize that gain when you sell it. You can get cash flow off of it. It can pay its own bills. It can pay down equity. You can force appreciation. All that thing's great, but you don't realize that gain until you sell it. So we put everything we had up for sale, and it's been absolutely insane. We understand owner finance, so we're owner financing most of what we have. And we got a guy that's given us $120,000 down on a mobile home park. Well, basically what it does from a bookkeeping side of things, it cleans our books up, because now, you know, we've got a note and 120 grand in the bank. So we're liquid and we've got a note on our books instead of a liability. It makes us extremely lendable for the small apartment deals we want to do, the agency loans that we want to get. So it's kind of, we were already restructuring our entities because we were holding properties, too many properties in a single entity. We were breaking all that stuff off beforehand, but now this kind of forced us into a deal where we wanted to see what the market was, and the market is insane. So, I mean, we're owner finance, and we're gonna end up with probably $500,000 or $600,000 in the bank from owner finance down payments and a bunch of notes on our books that we otherwise wouldn't have tested that side of the market. And that, with that liquidity, plus the how much better a note looks on your book than, you know, 19 or 20 units. We're going to go after some much bigger deals. As we anticipate older, tireder landlords, this kind of pushes them out because they don't have the bandwidth. They don't want to deal with it. It's kind of like this. I'm sitting on $200,000. I'm about to lose, you know, 20 tenants. I'm going to have to go spend that $200,000 to get those back going. I'm at the end of lifespan on my ACs, my roofs, all of this. The property needs work. I could completely get away from it and put cash in the bank, or I could empty out my bank account to make it good again and try to lease it up one more time, and I'm 80 years old. What are you going to do? You're tapping out. You're getting out of the way, and you're going to give it away at a discount. We are currently positioning ourselves from all side of things so we can take advantage of that as that starts happening. So that's really the goal and how it shifted our business plan.
You know, it's been crazy because, I don't know, 2 months ago, I never would have thought that inventory would be at such a premium, vacant inventory, right? That's investment grade, whether it be, you know, on your side of the business with multifamily, or it be flips, you know, whatever it is, right? But now here we are, fast forward to right now today. I mean, finding inventory is probably as difficult as it's been in recent past. At least it is around here. When 60 days ago, I thought this was going to be like a gold rush of inventory coming to those that stuck around, but it really didn't turn out that way.
Well, I think when I saw people start talking about that, I was like, I don't necessarily see it as an opportunity, because if you take evictions off the board, or if you take foreclosures off the board, if you take tax suits off the board, I mean, all of these different layers of motivation. I mean, even from having to pay your normal bills, you're like, banks were reaching out like, hey, you don't have to pay your car note this month. When has that ever happened? Ever? So, what if you didn't lose your job, okay, or you lost your job and now you're getting a pay raise with unemployment, because that's what was happening with a lot of people, and now you don't have to pay 90% of your bills, and you can't go do anything that you would normally spend money on, you know what I mean? You can do absolutely nothing. You can shop on Amazon. You can do TikToks on your back porch. Like, what motivation do you have to sell a house anymore? You might be sitting on the most money that you've ever sat on as a homeowner ever. You know what I mean? So, yeah, I was like, inventory has been crazy hard. And everybody that's like, oh, I'm killing it, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, I'm like, man, maybe. But no, it's not been. We re-upped our bandit signs. One thing about it was putting out bandit signs was never easier during Rona. Just go put one at the grocery store. You know what I mean? You put out one at the grocery store, you get everybody. You got the whole town. So
it's true.
didn't have to guess about it. Where are you bandit signing? Around the grocery store. There's no other place people can go. They ain't leaving their house for no other reason.
That's funny. Yeah, I haven't thought about that, but you get every bit of traffic at the grocery store, and that was pretty much it. Yeah, it was the weirdest thing, man. You're right. The amount of money that got pumped into everything, I've never seen anything like it. And I was, you know, in real estate the last go around 2008, financial collapse and all that. But, you know, there was the home buyer tax credit that got dumped into the market. We should have all bought as much Apple stock as we could have on March 23rd. And we'd be able to go out and buy as much apartment buildings as we want right about now. But the down and up in the stock market, I've never seen anything this crazy in terms of that.
And that was another factor, you know, if you had anybody with any sort of liquidity that is savvy, was investing in real estate to be diversified, you know, it's kind of like, they're looking at the stock market going, it isn't going to be there forever. They're eyeing it and knowing that it's going to be a generational opportunity to buy the dip. You know, we have one guy that he had 100,000 out with us and he's like, man, if I could get that 100 back, we're like, why? He's like, I want to buy the dip. We're like, what are you talking about? The stock market's at an all-time low. I just want to go buy some shit on the stock market because it'll be worth three times as much, you know, when this thing's over. Like, well, now me and you both know he was right, you know. But to me, the stock market is such a mystery, and this just further complicates it for me because I don't understand why it's doing as good as it is. Like beef prices, I was looking at beef prices. I couldn't figure that out. I couldn't figure out why cattle on the hoof didn't go negative like oil did. When oil went negative, that made sense to me. Cattle should have been the same way. You should have had ranchers paying people to take them off their hands because they're costing ranchers money just piled up because they can't go to the meat packing. Basically, the demand is down because there's no restaurants open. Mm-hmm. And meat packing places said, oh, well, we want to keep the prices up. So, you know, they were having Rona outbreaks. But you got to think about it. If 90% of your staff got Rona, 2 weeks later, you're back in full business. You know what I mean? Unless they died. But otherwise, you're herd immunity. You can go back to work. You know what I mean? So there was some real strange stuff there with the price of cattle that I didn't understand. Like, why is it staying up? Still wasn't enough for ranchers to make money, but it didn't make sense that it was still as high as it was. So I quit paying attention to it. You got enough stuff that you can consume in a day. And to me, trying to solve the mysteries of the stock market would just make my head hurt and then make me a little bit sad. And I was like, maybe I just need to go out here and try to go buy a house. But you know, the crazy thing was driving for dollars. You got the driving for dollars app. No better time to go drive for dollars than during Rona because you needed vacant inventory to be able to look at anything almost. So how are you going to do that? You're going to have to get off your ass and go drive for dollars. And to be quite honest, after you sat at home on 2 days of Netflix, once Tiger King was done, what else were you going to do? You know what I mean? It's like Tiger King is the best thing I've ever seen on TV, but you know, it was over in a day or two. So after that, you got to go back to work.
Yeah. That was a hell of a phenomenon, wasn't it? That was, I think that was strategically dropped for Rona enjoyment, but that guy's something else. I'd love to get him on a podcast someday. Holy hell. But all right. Well, yeah, Rona's crazy, man. In hindsight, I don't know who knows? I don't know how they're going to write this in the history books, but I'll tell you what, it's been a hell of a ride this last 3 months. I couldn't have told you what was going to happen looking back. That's for damn sure. But here we are, right?
We're here. And that's, you know, I had this conversation with Witherspoon today. You know, some people feel like they need to go get a job to have that security that, oh man, I got that steady income. I've been laid off twice working in the oil field, which is how I got into real estate, which is why my Facebook group's called Roughnecked Real Estate. But on hindsight, like everything looking back, it's like right now in the worst financial crisis in the world, I was still in control of what I could or couldn't do. And I could go find a vacant house. I have the skill set to dig back out and find the 50 heirs. I have DocuSign to be able to get them to sign something so I don't have to give them Rona. You know what I mean? And all the tools at my disposal to be able to earn an income where when oil prices crashed and all my friends in the oil field were just getting laid off overnight, they would have never imagined. I had one guy that worked for a company for 20 years and just called him up, said, hey, bro, we don't need you anymore. $170,000 a year job gone. 20 years of his life gone. Just overnight, like no warning, no nothing, just see you, have a nice day. me, I was like, you know, I don't necessarily, I mean, I could make a lot more money. We put all of it back into the company. I'm not into lifestyle and stuff like that, but I don't have to worry about groceries. I don't have to worry about my car payment. I don't have to worry about being able to go do something with Emery when I'm going to go do something with Emery. I'm in 100% control. I can go find a vacant house right now. I can find the owners. I can talk them into selling it, and I can put that into the marketplace and make money. It's amazing. Yeah,
I will say you are probably one of the more, it's not my word, but it's thrown out there a lot, one of the more savage marketers I think I've ever known in my life, in terms of being able to go out into the marketplace, find a product that's investment grade, talk to the people that own it. You do throw some crazy shit out though, get people to talk to you, and I think you're the only person on the planet that I know that can get away with it, because some people can, some people can't, but you definitely get away with it. And then you rope it in, turn it into a deal, put it out to the marketplace, sell it, make money. I mean, you've got that down. I think there's no question. And they having or knowing how to do that and knowing that you can rinse and repeat that, it's a real powerful thing. And that's what you're saying. A lot of your guys that you know that gave 20 years of their life to another, you know, organization or business, they get that stripped away. They don't have that, right? They don't have that feeling, that confidence. And it's, man, it's door number two. It's the blue pill when you can do that. It just changes the way you look at life. It really does.
It really does. Because, I mean, it's like you got a badass resume and nobody's hiring. You know what I mean? I've got a skill set that I can lean into at any moment in time. Any moment in time, it gets really hairy. Like, I've got all these other things, these side projects I like to work on. I like to build content, all this kind of stuff. I can throw all that shit to the side, and I can go right back to the streets and make it happen. I was sending out text messages whenever all this started going. I was like, hey, my text marketing said, while there's still money left in my 401k, while the stock market's crashing, I was like, while there's still money left in my 401k, I need to buy a house. What do you got? You know what I mean? Like, can I get something? And I was, you know, sending those text messages out, and people were like, dude, it's crazy. I'm sorry. When Rona was happening, just this last week, I said, between Rona and riots, I'm ready to get out of the city. I was marketing about an hour out of the Metroplex. I was like, between Rona and riots, I'm ready to get out of the city. You know, do you have any interest in selling property at address, whatever? And people were, I got a deal off of that. Like, we're going to lock it up in a day, where dude's like, yeah, I'll take $60,000 for it. It's probably a 120 house. We're going to get it for 50, and it's 120 as is. So crazy deal.
That was straight text message marketing, just with a little bit of a twist on the message.
Just a little bit of twist on the message. Hey, between Rona and riots, I'm tired of living in the Metroplex. You have any interest in selling bang address? That was it. And it caught, and you know, and the responses are, you know, sometimes they're a little off, and you know, all that kind of stuff. But the thing about that type of message is it lets them know that they're not talking to a bot, and it's not necessarily automated. You know what I mean? They're like, this is a human being texting me. It kind of keeps you under the radar.
Yeah. It's, what do they call it? Pattern interrupt, right? I mean, it's definitely different than, like, I got two text message markets, an investor hit me up with text message marketing last week, and I got a couple rental properties that they pulled off of the same list. And so I got it for the first one, and then like 15 seconds later, I got it for the second one. So they didn't scrub their data well, and they hit me back to back, but it was a very like blase vanilla message, right? I'm interested in your property at 123, whatever. And now if I got somebody like you text me and said, hey, this Ronan riots is driving me crazy, man. Can I get out of the city? You got a house I can buy? It would probably intrigue me to have a course, you know, back and forth with them a hell of a lot more than just go, delete, you know, regardless of whether or not I'm a real estate investor.
And I don't, the program we're using, it's, they just did an update. And so you put in 10 text messages and they're completely different. If it's more than 70% like it, it will not let you enter that in as a second message. And it actually sends a different message. So like, let's say you have, there's two numbers on file for you. It sends two different messages. So if it's you and your wife on the same cell phone plan, y'all both get the same message. It won't be the same message. Gotcha. It'll be a version of it. So I was pissed whenever I was having to put in those 10 different messages. I was like, this is some bullshit. Just let me go to work. I just want to send my message. I don't want to have to rethink it and change words. And you know what I mean? But once I figured out what was happening, I was like, oh man, that's clean. Like that's going to increase our response rate for that reason that you just said.
Yeah, no, it's, you got some great marketing ideas. I got to hand it to you. I think, you know, back when I first got into real estate, the thing was these gurus would say, hey, drop me in any city and within 24 hours, I'll have a deal. I think you pretty much could be that guy. I could drop you in any city and I think you could pretty much go find at least a quasi good deal in a short amount of time, and probably a really good deal if I gave you a couple of days.
I, I tried it in Arizona. I got my ass kicked until I found Apache Junction. Once I found Apache Junction, I was home. But nobody would think those are deals. But, man, there's some shit boxes in there. I was like, dude, people are paying $300,000 for a single-family home out here, and you can come buy a $10,000 home that you can sell for $150. Yeah, I'm going to this $10,000 junk over here that'll sell for $150 all day. This deal that we're closing on now, like, that's why I'm sitting outside. We bought it for $25,000. We listed it on MLS for $90,000 and got a $60,000 cash offer in Rona. Like, it's out in the middle of nowhere, but it's on an acre of land. And it's, I mean, you can kind of see, I mean, we're in a little bushy part of Texas that you can get to from Austin within an hour. That's all you got to do. If you can get to any major metroplex within an hour, you can make money in no matter how many neighbors it has. It's a crazy phenomenon that nobody takes advantage of.
Does anybody else market out there?
They're starting. The problem is no lenders will loan.
Oh.
So okay. I in Texas, I just became a lender with Jet Lending. So R2R at Jet Lending, if you have a deal that you want to loan on in Texas, but we have the ability to go out and loan in these areas. Talk to the owner, you know. And he's doing deals out here too. And I was like, oh, you get it. And he's like, oh, I definitely get it. And I'm like, all right, man. You know, and he kind of asked me if I wanted to come on. His name's Eddie Gann. He's done 3,000 hard money loans. He's done over 1,700 flips himself. I mean, he's a home investors guy, been doing it for 20 years. I mean, and he's underwriting your deal. So if you think you got a home run, you're about to find out. Like, there isn't a guru on planet Earth that can underwrite a deal as well as Eddie Gann. And he gets to evaluate your deal if you try to use us as a lender. So it's like you get, you know, people pay $20,000 for that handholding, and you could just submit loans to us all day, and Eddie Gant's going to shit on your deal or tell you, oh, shit, that's a good deal. So
that's funny. Yeah, I guess I never thought about the money side of it, but a lot of people are probably just scared to put money to work out in rural areas like that because they don't know how they're going to get it back necessarily. But you've kind of got that puzzle put together, and it's – I mean, it's almost like some people go to tertiary markets because they're less competition, but you guys skip right past that, go all the way to the rural markets, which there's basically no competition. It's just knowing the market that you can actually sell it to an end user or an end buyer at some point.
And the backstop of that is owner finance. So it's like this. We would have sold that house $90,000 owner finance, and we would have got $10,000 down. So our cost basis would have been somewhere around, let's just call it 20, right? Just for simple numbers, realtor fees, everything. Let's just say we got $20,000 in that deal, but we're sitting with a note that's $81,000 or $80,000, right? Got an $80,000 note over the top of a $20,000 cost basis. I can sell that note for 20. I mean, you go look at what the yield would be, but 25, 30, being able to sell that note on the backside to a note buyer. And that's the part that most people miss. In these local, rural, small markets, all of the lawyers, attorneys, title companies, everything here, they do real estate investing too. So they'll buy your note. You bring them an established, well-paying note, they'll buy it from you because it's less work they have to do. They didn't have to put that deal together, and you can profit like that. Or you can take a portfolio of those notes, go to a bank and hypothecate your money and, you know, borrow money against your notes. So there's a lot of ways to get your money back out of them once you owner finance them that most people don't know. So they don't use that strategy. That's our backstop in all of these deals is I know I can owner finance it. Push comes to shove, I know I can owner finance it. Now I don't have to deal with property management on it. I don't have to deal with repairs, but I can get cash flow on it, and I can get my capital back out of it if I need to by selling that note or borrowing against it.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. I hadn't really thought about that. So there you go, everybody. A little bit of golden nuggets from Mr. Corey Thompson. All right, let's segue because I don't want to step on our mutual friend Steve Trang. He's bringing his show back to this afternoon, so I don't want to rob viewers from him, being that he's bringing disruptors back. But and I think he's kicking off at 2 today. But I want to talk some shit before we get to the end of this show, or give you the opportunity, maybe not talk shit, but enlighten us, right?
Okay.
So you posted something online, I don't know, maybe a week ago, 2 weeks ago, and it was some lawsuit litigation paperwork, slap claim, I think it was, from a gentleman that is, we'll say, in the guru world, the education world, the real estate education world, and apparently you now have to defend yourself against something. And so I wanted to kind of get your take on how this even happened, because there's a lot of shit talking that happens on social media and back and forth and blah, blah, blah. How in the hell did you get into a situation now where you've got a legal lawsuit against you for what I think is just talking smack online, right?
Yeah, pretty much. So Roughnecks Real Estate Facebook group, just a thing. Didn't really ever plan on monetizing it. Hadn't done a very good job of monetizing it. So there's that. I think a lot of people saw it from the outside and thought if I had one of those, I could make a lot of money. And this cat was one of them. So essentially what happened was he entered Roughnecks Real Estate. He looked legit. The reasons he looked legit was because of some things that I won't mention because that's what got me sued. So he looked the part. So I interviewed him on the podcast. You know, pretty normal. Didn't necessarily, he said he had a hedge fund and all this kind of stuff. I don't know how to look that stuff up. Wasn't big into it. I mean, we're talking 2018, I think, when I interviewed this guy. Wasn't really trying to you know, just a normal interview. He'd asked me for some lenders and stuff like that in the DMs. We kind of communicated to that extent. But all the stuff that he was posting online made him look more legit than maybe he is, okay? Now, I'm not saying the guy hasn't bought real estate. That's not, you know, only thing I'm saying is that you need to look into him, need to look into some of his tactics. So, rock on there. He's in Roughnecks Real Estate. He's a big part of Roughnecks Real Estate a little bit, like a lot of people talk to him, because he's this flashy hedge fund guy. He wanted to look like a flashy hedge fund guy, so he looks like a flashy hedge fund guy. And we all somewhat trust him. He had our trust. He had Roughnecks Real Estate's trust and everything else. Some things started coming out, and it was, you know, kind of being said. And I asked him about it, and he would give an explanation, and I would take it at face value, and, you know, just kind of like that. But I was like, you know what? I'm going to dissociate myself. I'm not going to do this. Anyways, he started promoting his coaching business. He wasn't coaching at the time. He started promoting his coaching business and R2R, and I shut it down. I made a video where I mocked him because it was just a dumb shit ad that he put on the internet. So I made a dumb shit ad mocking his dumb shit ad to kind of let him know, because nobody else knows who he is. They don't know who he is right now, to let him know this shit ain't going to fly. Like, we're not going there. That ad was mentioned in the lawsuit, which the ad doesn't mention it. Fast forward, a friend of mine, she had loaned us money. She loaned money out of IRA. She saw me speak on stage. I call her a friend. She's a real good human. And we'd done some deals together. She had, in May, put down money for his coaching. And the next day went to his seminar and realized he didn't have a coaching package at the price point that he had sold her. And so she felt like he had taken advantage of her just because she had the money. She wanted her money back because she also didn't believe that he could do what he said he could do, because when he, you know, anyways, I won't put words in her mouth, but she wanted her money back. Rocks on, she couldn't get her money back for 3 months. So she asked me, hey, I seen on your podcast, you know, could you possibly, you know what I mean? Like, reach out to him and see what the deal with this money is. And so I messaged him. And he said essentially that he was speaking on stage with Grant Cardone, Tony Robbins, and a couple other people, and that me being concerned about his business was a real indication of where my business was. And thanks for my concern, Corey's concern about it, and we should eat lunch when he gets back to town. And I was like, that's an odd response. You know what I mean? Like, that was literally my response to him. Like, that was an odd response. So I do what I always do. I go to the backyard and make a video on Roughnecks Real Estate, letting people know that this had happened. I didn't mention his name, didn't tell anybody about it, whatever. He gives the money back. He gives her back her money, like some sort of fucking magic. He gives back the money. So that instance, he, in the lawsuit, sued for tortious interference of that contract. Okay. It'll come back here in a second. This is going to crack you up. So we never mentioned him in that video, but after that, after she had her money back and everything else, I went and edited the podcast and said at the beginning, hey, do your own due diligence. Here's some things that I heard happen. Here, do your own due diligence. I'm not associated with this cat. He's not associated with Roughnecks Real Estate. If you're going to do business with him, do your own due diligence. So that's one. Two, another lady reached out to me. We paid her a $400,000 assignment fee on her apartment complex. We've done business. She reached out to me and asked if she should do business with him or Carlos Reyes, And I told her, I was like, look, Carlos is more transparent. What are you wanting to learn? She told me, I was like, if it was me, I would go with Carlos. I don't know that homeboy, you know, I don't know enough about his business to know if he could show you that. If he showed you some things that I don't know about, you might give him some consideration. But if it's me, I'm using Carlos. So she went with Carlos. So that's another one that was cited in the lawsuit. So two particular people that he didn't get to do business with as torturous interference with a contract for coaching in the lawsuit, alleged. So lawsuit goes forward. Never been a part of a lawsuit. Don't know the process. This first part's done in affidavit, so we're doing affidavits. It's just weird, whatever. So we file everything. We get to the court hearing, and I didn't have to go to the court hearing. We couldn't because of Rona, so it was all on Zoom, and my attorney's like, you don't have to do there. So they're arguing over the affidavits for the anti-slap, which is going to get it thrown out, and then, you know, he'll have to pay my legal fees and all that kind of crap. So they're going back and forth, and the judge is like, hey, I seen a contract on here. You know, I seen that there's torturous interference of the contract. Why do I not have a copy of the contract? Like, oh, well, we got it right here. He starts asking for details off the contract, and the contract between the lady that gave him money and he eventually gave it back. Anyways, that contract was with a different entity. So he sued me with him personally, and his hedge fund sued me. But the contract was with a coaching company that the hedge fund doesn't own, and that isn't a party to the suit. So the judge is like, well, this ain't a party to the suit. Like, you know what I mean? Like, why? You know what I mean? Like, why is this in the suit? Like, there's the party to the suit in there. So I ultimately, the judge doesn't have to explain why he threw it out. He doesn't have to. I don't know if he will or not, but he threw it out. He threw out, you know, all five claims, the defamation, the interference with the lawsuit, all of that. And now we're going through the process for legal fees and all that. And I'm sure he'll appeal it. I don't know that, but you know, I would think that it's probably going to happen. My lawyer fees right now to date are $71,000. So $71,000. Like you said, you know, you spent some money in this situation. Maybe it goes to the appellate court. Maybe it goes all the way to Texas Supreme Court. Maybe we're victorious through it all, and he's ultimately responsible for the legal fees. Maybe that's how it goes. I don't know. But at the end of the day, to me, it's like, why would you roll that dice? Like, why? You know what I mean? Like, if people are out on the internet right now saying, you know, you need to do more due diligence on Tucker. You know what I mean? You might respond to it and be like, I got your due diligence right here, bitch. Bam. You know what I mean? Like, but to go about it in this way is kind of a weird deal where it's like, we're gonna spend a shitload of money that if it's victorious, I'm going to have a judgment against Corey Thompson that will be worth less than your toilet paper in your local bathroom. Because, you know, I mean, how do you go about enforcing a judgment? I mean, it's like, it's just a dumb process from start to finish that I don't understand. No, I can't. When people ask me, like you asked me, I couldn't tell you. But one thing that is of concern of mine is I was sued by a hedge fund. So I've got SEC attorneys lined up to do interviews because I want to know how, if there was legal fees paid with the hedge fund, how does it have to be disclosed to the investors? Because it's worth noting that these, you know, if I take my money and I invest it in a hedge fund, that's my retirement. I worked hard for that money. I want it to grow. And you know, you're going to go put it at risk for a judgment that you might not be able to enforce, that, you know what I mean? You get $1 million judgment, and what are the chances of collecting it? You know, it's kind of hard. So I don't know what the goal was, but you know, it's not over yet. We'll figure out where it goes from here, but hopefully we get this over with soon, from the perspective that we'll, you know, the judge is going to rule on how much attorney's fees we're entitled to and all that. And if they appeal it, we'll go to the appellate court, and at the point that it goes to the appellate court, you know, there's no guarantee that the Supreme Court will pick it up. So it could be dead after the appellate court, but, you know, we kind of, I guess I like my chances personally. I don't like my chances of collecting that $71,000. I know ultimately that's going to be paid for out of my own pocket. But
you know what? You know what I discovered, and I mentioned on your forum, and I'll just mention it again, is I've been sued twice. Once, I understand the frustration in the people that sued me. They had some water intrusion in their basement, and they wanted to blame me for what was a historic amount of snow and then rain, which created flooding, which created water in their basement. It wasn't really faulty. It wasn't faulty construction, but they were angry. So I understand. And we ended up just settling, and I paid them a healthy sum of money just as like, okay, I get it. Here you go. Right. So I don't hold it against those people for, we just renovated the house and sold it to them. And it happened way later, but everybody gets pissed and shit rolls downhill. Right. So they got to go after somebody. I was that somebody. The other one, we were frivolously sued by a gal that lived next door to one of our projects. And believe it or not, her last name was Sadist. That was her last name. And trust me, she was she fit the bill. And we actually had an event for our mastermind group probably 3 years ago here in Portland. And I had a whole bus full of people that were in the mastermind group. And we drove by the house and I had them all give her the finger still. And that was probably 4 years later after. But what I learned in that one, because that was the one that really wasn't warranted at all, because she literally sued us over a bush that was straddled the property line. She said we damaged this lilac bush, and we didn't. It was fine. But she had a family that were a bunch of attorneys, and they basically filed paperwork after paperwork on her behalf without billable hours. And so they created a slap claim against me. The slap claim got thrown out of court. It cost me a bunch of money to defend myself and get that thrown out. But then they just made it clear that they were going to keep filing and keep filing and keep filing every piece of paperwork that they could possibly file, because they knew that I had billable hours just like you did, right? So the game was to try and extort me for money. And ultimately she won that game, but I had to make the decision of, in my case anyway, is it worth paying this terrible human being X amount of dollars to just go away, or keep this in my life for the next year and continue paying for it one way or the other? Cause I'm going to pay my legal fees, because my attorney's not doing work pro bono, but she had an attorney that was. So what I found out, moral of the story, is that if you mess with people that have friends or family that are attorneys that will do the work on their behalf, as ridiculous as it is, you know, you're pretty much fighting a losing battle. You can't really win that battle because they don't have legal fees to pay, and legal fees ain't cheap, as you found out.
Yeah, they're $400 an hour. So, you know, and the funny thing about that, at least from my side of things, it's, it's kind of like what my attorney asked me at the beginning. He's like, you know, we had to take all the videos down. They put in like, I can't remember how many pages, of course. They basically tried to say at the beginning of the suit that every time I mentioned Guru Online, it was talking about them. And so they had this crazy list of posts where I'd said the word guru to take down. And we had to negotiate what post to take down. They went for a temporary restraining order, all kinds of goofy stuff. So all that happened, right? So we go through that. And my attorney says, you know, they probably just want these posts down. You know, why would you go through with this? Like, why continue the fight? And I'm like, if I didn't believe in what I said when I said it, I wouldn't have said it. And for me, it's like, if somebody comes out and they're just gonna frivolously sue you to make you be quiet on the internet, right? This is gonna be a part of my life for as long as I am on the internet. Like, this is going to be. Like, you know what I mean? You're going to have, like, I'm going to have to fight this battle either today, tomorrow, 10 years from now. I'm going to have to fight this battle. I wish I'd have had some different things in place. I have different things in place now, but I didn't. And that's on me. But now I have those things in place. So it'll be all right. Winning this at whatever the initial cost is, if it's $200,000, if it's $250,000, whatever the initial cost is, it's better now to pay it on the front side than it is to leave it open for a later date. You know what I mean? It's better in the long run for everybody in the community that can speak their mind to not have to go worry about litigating this on their own or on their own behalf, you included. You know what I mean? Imagine the endless possibilities if this lawsuit was won in the other side for anybody that puts out content on the internet.
Oh, it'd be horrible. Yeah, I mean, terrible. And that's why I want to talk about it, because, I mean, basically, you're a content machine, right? And And most people, you know, you want people to watch your stuff. So some of it's, you know, inflammatory, not necessarily you, but just in nature, right? You want content to be entertaining. So it's like, can you really get sued for just talking smack on the internet? Like, it seems crazy, but it's happening, right?
You can. And there, that's what the anti-slap is there for. You know, I wanted to ask for sanctions. You know, maybe we do. Maybe we get them. Because if we do get sanctions, that'll be, you know, in the event that it's paid, it'll be protection against future legal fees. Now, my attorney is awesome. He's a great guy. And, you know, he's I don't know. I think he was right from the beginning about what he thought this case would end up being as far as, you know, how the case law plays out, because there's not a lot of case law in cases like this. But, you know, ultimately, if we do have to go before the Texas Supreme Court, you know, Corey Thompson's name will be on some case law in Texas, which is just, you know, I'll never quit talking about that. Like, I will talk about that. I'll open up every show with it forever. You know, if in the event I get some case law in the state of Texas at the Supreme Court level. So we'll see how it plays out.
So last question, as we're approaching the hour here, you got like 10 million followers on TikTok yet? Because all this.
I got on TikTok. TikTok is just a different animal, man. I don't understand it. I did a video, you know, around a country song I know, and it mentions a strip club. And I just happened to be driving by the strip club going to one of our properties. So I stopped and I hit the pole that was in front of it because you know, the lyrics say she works down at the timeout off of 155. And so I showed the sign on 155. I showed the timeout sign, and then I hit the pole on the timeout sign to the lyrics, and that band shared it. So anyways, I got TikTok famous like instantly, 400,000 views. I was like, yeah, that was it. Just gotta be willing to tuck your shirt up and dance on the pole just like everybody else that's famous on TikTok.
Yeah, I went down the TikTok rabbit hole a couple days ago for the first time, and I was like, oh my god. So yeah,
it is
one.
that algorithm is nuts. Like, China has that shit figured out. I don't know who did the algorithm for TikTok. It's insane. Like, you know, DJ, high school kid that works for us, he fell off a porch and he had a lump on his ass. And so DJ's got this big, ugly ass. And then he's got a big, ugly lump on the side of it that's like purple. And it's, you can see it. Like, it's like, it's protruding. And so I made a TikTok of it. I like pulled down his pants and showed it to him. And the algorithm recognized that was a butt instantly. And I mean, it's not an attractive butt. It just looked like, I don't know, a bag of mashed potatoes or something. But it knew it was a butt. And like, I had my first TikTok banned video. I was like, man, that was crazy. It didn't even let it upload. So that algorithm is, they're definitely spying on us. So if you get TikTok, just know that everybody knows what's going on.
Oh yeah, I bet. All right. Well, hey, I've taken an hour of your time. You got a lot going on today. We're actually buying one today too. I got to wrap up here when we're done. But for those people that are listening that obviously haven't followed you yet, what's the best way for them to go find you and get entertained, not only on your stripper TikTok videos, but maybe some real estate related stuff on Facebook also?
Roughneck Real Estate Facebook group's the easiest place. Got a YouTube channel. It's a little bit more serious. It's all serious. It kind of makes me sad how serious my YouTube is, but it's hard to video yourself doing YouTube videos, and it takes a lot of hours to put that stuff together. Like, you know, everybody knows.
Oh yeah.
TikTok's easy. I can do one. I just did one here. There's a rooster eating bugs in the grass at the Wells Fargo here in Bastrop, Texas. And I was like, yep, this is the most Texas thing I've ever seen in my life. The Wells Fargo here in Bastrop has their own rooster.
And you probably got 8 million views on that video now too, right? So
probably.
All right. Well, hey man, I appreciate you coming on and just kind of shooting the shit today. And I wish you the best of luck in the lawsuit stuff. It'll all work out one way or the other. We learn and we earn, right? And you're doing a little bit of learning on that one, it sounds like. But, you know, such is life.
It'll all work out in the end. Appreciate all right, man. Your time.
All right. Well, thanks for coming on, and we'll talk to you soon.